Good morning, everyone. I hope my voice and image finds you in the presence of your family and friends, having fun and enjoying the moment with an equal mix of satisfaction and gratitude. It's a big achievement to gain a Middlesex diploma, and you've had a number of people both behind you and traveling with you along the way, your parents, guardians, your primary school teachers, alumni of the school who have been stewards of this place long before you even arrived, those who have cared for you in a thousand different ways. Before we get started, I encourage you to turn to your family and say, thank you. Go ahead, I'll wait. As Angelo reminded us, just a few weeks ago in his chapel, we indeed all have blessings. I want you to know that your presence here has been a blessing to the Middlesex community. I can tell you that at this very moment, you have more than a campus worth of supporters, faculty, staff, administrators, alumni, your fellow Middlesex students, friends of the school, who are watching this at the very same time. And they're proud of you, and they're proud of our school. So congratulations to our seniors, and welcome to you all. So I will say a few words, and then I'm gonna turn it over to Jimmy Simons, your valedictorian. Dear seniors, families, friends, faculty, trustees, alumni, and students, I don't know about you, but I've been giving a fair bit of thought to the subject of masks these days. They're not the kind of masks I used to think about if I thought about masks at all. Pre-pandemic, my mask thinking was only vaguely academic, about the Commedia dell'arte or the character Tanino in Pagliacci singing about how he must turn his distress into jokes. Vesti la giubba e la faccia in farina, la gente paga e rider vuole qua. Put on your costume and powder your face, Tanino sings. The people are paying and they want to laugh here. Masks, for me as a kid, were vaguely creepy, perhaps an expression of inauthenticity or an artificial license to do or act in ways that we otherwise would not. Of course, these are not the masks I'm thinking about today. The reality of masks in our lives these days is much more immediate. Governor Charlie Baker was not talking about operatic characters when he ordered Massachusetts residents to wear face coverings. He was thinking about preventing disease and saving lives. In the part of the country where I grew up, I'm a little embarrassed to admit, we now have anti-mask movements, a sort of don't tread on me notion that somehow looking after the common good precludes personal freedom. I'd like us to think together on this graduation day about what our attitude towards wearing masks and even the masks we choose to wear can suggest about who we are and our aspirations as members of the Middlesex community. Our mask wearing these days reveals much more than it conceals. Of course, there's the no mask option that some of my Pacific Northwest sisters and brothers have adopted. Is it that some believe surely that no harm can come to me? And conversely, that my existence, my breath, my coughs, my sneezes will have no impact on the rest of the world? This seems to me naive at best. Then there's the relatively secure option of the N95 mask with the little valve on the front. I was just reading Atul Gawande's excellent article in The New Yorker about how the Mass General Brigham's hospital system has minimized the spread of COVID-19 within the clinical setting. Dr. Gawande suggests that these types of masks are appropriate for situations in which you want to keep things out, dust, for example, but that valve, which makes breathing more comfortable for the wearer, does not actually filter pathogens potentially headed towards others. He describes these types of masks as a sort of I protect me, I expose you model, Clearly, this doesn't seem right either. Although the wearer recognizes the harm that may come to them, there's still a failure of reciprocal imagination here, or an unwillingness to place oneself in the shoes of another. The gold standard, of course, is a well-fitting N95 mask without the valve. While there's no such thing as absolute certainty, the mask protects the wearer and also protects those persons around the wearer. These masks, reports Gwande, are uncomfortable to breathe through for extended periods of time. But at the cost of some discomfort, the wearer not only attends to their own health, but actively safeguards the health of others. It seems to me that the ethos of the no-valve N95 mask is exactly what your Middlesex education is all about. When I wrote to you some weeks ago about working from home during this pandemic, I suggested that the springtime was an opportunity to reflect on the profound education of head and heart that takes place in your teams, in the classroom, in your relationships with your advisor, in your relationships with your friends, in your classmates. The hard work and discipline you've put into your engagement here with Middlesex, as well as the good guidance of your parents and adults at school, has resulted in real power. And that's power you should use with great care. You can now read and look with sensitivity and sophistication, giving you access to literature and poetry, technical papers, artworks, and a critical apprehension of the content and images of contemporary media. You know what it means to work hard and come together as a team. You've learned the lessons of the ice, the fields, the courts, the boards, the rehearsal rooms, and the labs. However much you railed against the blue sheets and paragraph tests, you know that you can write circles around just about everybody. You've experienced the possibilities, the glory, really, of a close community, and you know what it feels like when community falls short, as they inevitably do. And you know how much it requires of you and others to begin to bridge those shortfalls. There will be more learning to come, more powers to develop, and you will. But do not let those lessons exist for your enjoyment alone. Do not develop those powers for the purpose of consolidating and extending privilege. To do so is to wear an N95 mask with a one-way valve. It may protect you as you move about the world, but it is not a foolproof guarantee of freedom from harm, and it may be dangerous to others. Cultivate your sensibilities, of course, we must. Nourishing the self sustains us and delights us and prepares us for the important work we do in the world. But if we are to thrive, and our communities are to thrive along with us, we must attend equally to the well-being of others. What you do in the world, how you respond to challenge, how well you work, tending the good ground of yourself and the environments in which you have the privilege to be a part, that is the mark of a Middlesex graduate. That is the purpose and end of your education. There is, of course, one more type of mask that I haven't yet mentioned. That's the ordinary type of cloth mask we're wearing these days, or even the types of masks that surgeons wear. The intention of these masks is not to filter out pathogens in the surrounding air. They don't work that way. Their purpose is to look out for others. It is to prevent the unknowing or self-centered transmission of harm. Wearing ordinary cloth, when in concert with the efforts of others, begins to render the world more safe and livable. That's the case at Dr. Gwande's hospital in Boston. And so it can be with us. I protect you, you protect me, a sort of ideal community of mutual respect, support, and care. A community of mutual thriving, a sort of Jerusalem. So to close, let me recall you to the familiar words of William Blake. You know them well. I will not cease from mental strife, nor shall my sword sleep in my hand till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land. I want you to note two things here in this concluding stanza of that hymn we sing each week. First, that pleasant is not enough. The land is already pleasant, but in a substantial way, its cultivation is unfinished. And secondly, that the realization, the making real, the bringing into existence of what is ideal is the work of us all together. You've seen glimpses of that here at Middlesex. Although impermanent, they were not a mirage. Let this place and your involvement in its creation inspire you to continue to build Jerusalem in the world. Now go. I would like to introduce your valedictorian, Jimmy Simons, who will offer his thoughts on this occasion. And after Jimmy speaks, I'll return to award the diplomas.
Good morning, good evening, and good night to the class of 2020, wherever you are and whatever time it is for you at this moment. It's an honor to be chosen to address our class, to represent our class, an honor that I, along with many of you, I'm sure, was surprised to have received. At another school, it's a given that the most academically distinguished student addresses the class, the paragon of rigor and dedication. At our school, I get to address the class, which is even better. This is a valedictorian speech, though, as you can see, it is not a normal one. It's virtual, which is so much cooler than an in-person speech. And if you think differently, then you aren't very hip, are you? Choo-choo, that's the sound of the millennial bus leaving the station, taking all the ones and zeros with us, leaving the boomers on the platform. Perhaps a couple years down the road, graduating classes will be choosing of their own volition to digitalize their whole high school experience, graduation included. But this graduation is one that the class of 2020 would have liked to have on the circle on the steps of Elliott. A litany of unforeseen circumstances have caused us to graduate this way. A great number of us see this virtual compromise as tragic, a misfortune of cosmic proportions even. As such, you have chosen me, the undisputed beacon of the class of 2020's charisma, to valiantly lead you in this trying time, to be the people's champion, the JFK to your fear and fear itself. The fundamental challenge that we have to grapple with is that we are graduating, but it doesn't feel like it. If we were a typical senior class, we would spend the latter half of our year watching the circle as the snow turns to mud and rain and eventually into bright green grass. As our motivation for academic tasks wanes, we return our attention to other things, like the beauty of our school and the relationships that we cherish. Taking a collective breath in, we would all become struck by the finality of this experience and decide to squash petty rivalries, appreciate what deserves appreciation, and approach that graduation date with solemn bliss and the satisfaction of a job well done, of a fitting conclusion. At least I'm assuming this is what happens. I don't actually know. The point is, whereas typically the end of a senior's time at Middlesex crescendos towards its conclusion, in our case, things have been a little lackluster. It may even feel as though we don't even get a graduation. And if it doesn't feel like we get a graduation, then it starts to feel as though by means of each virtual class, each virtual valedictorian speech, our entire high school experience is slipping away. This is a problem. It's a problem not because there is some truth to it, but because there is none at all. In the same way that we have been assured time and time again that grades are not the most important part of a class, even though the college process makes us doubt it, so too is the end of high school not the most important part of high school. Not only should we refuse to look at ourselves as the COVID-19 class, but we are in fact not solely defined by this small complication to our wonderfully complicated Middlesex careers. I don't need to tell you all that our Middlesex journey began long before we heard the words coronavirus. Rather than focus on what didn't happen this year, we can choose to focus on what did happen, what we did accomplish, from the fall of 2016 to the present day. What we will take away from Middlesex is not simply a diploma. We have spent the formative years of our adolescence there, in our lovely bubble. We have struggled and we have overcome. We have met people and teachers who will remain with us for the rest of our lives, both in body and in spirit. As freshmen, we walked onto this campus wide-eyed and eager, some with many expectations and others with very few, but all not entirely prepared for what came next. We learned of what it means to coexist with people like us and people unlike us. For many, our new home was uncomfortable long before it was comfortable. We learned that some felt that personal hygiene was more a suggestion than an expectation. We learned that not everybody thinks the way we do, and that we had to persist nonetheless. We wrote some truly horrendous AB paragraphs, and eventually some slightly less horrendous AB paragraphs. There were highs, like the miraculous discovery that ice cream is available during any meal, and there were lows, like learning the hard way the value of sleep, a process that lasted well beyond freshman year for some. As sophomores, with the kind of soaring confidence that only arises from a full 9 months of high school under your belt, we were ready to tackle the coming year. Mr. Hirsch, however, saw to it that our confidence didn't last. The work got harder, but we got closer. We learned about the heroism and idealism from Hector and Gatsby. We also learned humility and had to accept the fact that our green room scene may not turn out perfect, but that those imperfections were honestly the best part. As sophomore year ended and we became juniors, we crossed that halfway threshold and for the first time saw college on the horizon. Some of us panicked, while others only panicked a little. We started signing up for AP classes because that mattered all of a sudden. We bought whiteboards for our room that we never used, and we started considering using our planners. We met our new classmate, the College Board, the friend that nobody really likes, but is also the only one with a car. So we indulged them and took their standardized tests because we kind of really needed them to get us to college. Junior year inevitably invites comparison to your peers, but by this point we knew better than to let that tendency come in between us. Finally, senior year was upon us, and with it the promise of conclusion. Though our work was not yet through, finally the period of questions slowly turned into one of answers. The uncertainty of our first 3 years was replaced by the confidence inherent to the concluding leg of our high school journey. As proctors, student leaders, club captains, and athletic captains, it was now our responsibility to answer the questions we ourselves had asked all those years ago. And indeed, achingly slowly, time began to give us answers to that perennial college question. Undoubtedly, we have come a tremendous distance. We have accomplished more than can be expressed concisely, more than can ever be taken away from us by a freak global pandemic. Clearly, it is critical that we remember this and safeguard our deserved pride against the torrent of current circumstances that cast a shadow over the world's class of 2020. We owe it to ourselves to celebrate. Against all odds, we made it. We are graduating and receiving our diplomas, and no amount of the virtual will make that fact any less real. But, no different than any high school graduation that has ever transpired, this is a bittersweet moment, a double-edged sword of triumph and farewell. As I began to write this speech and try to put some words on the page, I was struck by the fundamental paradox of the thing. My goal was to write about people, about a place whose meaning to me could simply not be summed up in 1,000 or so words. We now have to say goodbye to a place whose importance cannot be easily expressed. Yes, Middlesex has given us skills and developed our minds and souls in ways we could have never foreseen and will be eternally grateful for. But this is not what tugs on our heartstrings as we say goodbye. We are saying goodbye to our own individual mosaics of inexplicably extraordinary Middlesex moments. Moments like staying up freshman year with Cole, Mark, Justin, and Jack to watch Gordon Ramsay erotically salivate over his own cooking. Like playing football on a snow day circle and regretting it until you grabbed hold of that dining hall hot chocolate. Our mosaics are formed of incongruous images. Antonio's omelets, the pond on a bright blue day, and Mr. Bishop's somewhat comfortingly authoritarian dorm posters. They are composed of our failures and victories alike, the low of sleeping through an entire day of classes, and the high of that time HT and I got in disagreement about a physics lab, and I was actually right. The kind of thing that HT forgets immediately, but I will never forget. Ultimately, that's the point. Though it may seem as though nothing could be more important, more consequential, than the unusual circumstances of our senior year, in reality, we simply have more important things to do. Now is the time for us to appreciate the vast distance we have crossed individually and together. What we have gained from our school. What has been given to us. Simultaneously, we must discover how we can possibly part with this place, with friends and teachers who have left indelible marks on our souls, who have given us our invaluable mosaics. Now is the time for us to look to the future with confidence, confidence rightfully earned. Now is the time for us to say thank you. Thank you to our school, and thank you to everybody who made it what it is. I believe I speak for the class of 2020 when I say that I am eternally in this community's debt, a debt that we are excited to repay, if not to Middlesex, then to the world. Thank you, and good luck, class of 2020.
Thank you, Jimmy. It's now my honor and a great pleasure on behalf of the faculty of Middlesex School to award diplomas to the following students. With credit, Jessica Ajay. With credit, Carla Alexandra Albaran. With credit, Michael Brian Alieri. With credit, Michelle and Kunda. Kaylee Gabriella Arzu. With credit, Colette Lynn Oyang. Elizabeth Robinson Ayer. With credit, Victoria Hypatia Bagley. With credit, Ashley Nicole Batista. With credit, Daisy Campbell Boynton. With credit, Kylie Mary Brienne. With high credit, Kevin George Campbell. With credit, Wesley Haywood Capitani. Linnea Chantiz Cardine. With credit, Oliver Edward Cheever. With high credit, Chelsea Chung. With high credit, Manasi Sanjana Chintanami. With highest credit, Hyunte Choi. With credit, Cole Hing Cleary. With credit, Darren Cholak. With credit, Jack Walter Colwell. With high credit, William Michael Condi. With credit, Colin Jeffrey Craig. Colin James Cunningham. Lola Bell Davis. Arlen James Doughty. With credit, Sophia Dominic. With high credit, Tyler Milliken Dooling. With credit, Nina Rose Duje. With credit, Christopher Peter Wei Tai Elson. With credit, Averill Ann Emery. With high credit, James Jacob Ewing. Julian Lloyd Farr. With credit, Elena Fernandez. With high credit, Fiona Loveday Ferrone. With credit, Colin Robert Fink. With credit, Benjamin Miles Friedman. With credit, Harrison Daniel Friedman. With credit, Callan Thomas Fries. With credit, Lily Catherine Furtado. Dahlia Catherine Lucia Galante. With high credit, Riley Suzanne Galizio. With credit, Jose Adrian Garza. With high credit, Elizabeth Lee Gatto. Tyler Matthew Gellarmini. With credit, Phoebe Livingston Goltra. With credit, David Stanley Ford Hipsrow. With credit, Cole Wallace Hoodeman. With credit, Alexandra Elizabeth Joseph. With credit, Kofi Mackay King. With high credit, Jasmine Long Tzu Lam. With credit, Mayu Ayana Lee. With credit, Thomas Lee. Gregory David Linton. With highest credit, Allison Liu. With high credit, Hannah May Liu. With high credit, Yumin Liu. With credit, Bin An Wong. With credit, Ethan Malcolm McDougall. With credit, Sydney Jane McKeegan. with high credit, Anulo Arthur Macchiani. Anthony Christopher Mandravellis. With high credit, William Christian Walker Massey. Njari Andrea Adobe Mbakwe. With credit, Alexandra Margaret McLaughlin. With credit, Hayden Rockwood Monahan. With credit, Isabel Cecilia Moore. With credit, Brooke Elizabeth Murphy. With credit, Nedochukwu Ryan Nwobo. With credit, Coleman Ashwell Pyle Nye. Hannah Catherine O'Gara. With credit, Oluwanafemi Adedoyin Ogunseye. With credit, Eamon John O'Malley. Natalie Hatsuki Amori Hoff. With high credit, Justin Lawrence O'Toole. With credit, Cedric Paradis. With credit, Jeremy Flor Patrocinio. With credit, Isabel LeBlanc Patry. Matthew Joseph Pelletier. Aaron Joseph Peroni. With credit, Catherine Stevens Pitelli. Justin Xavier Polonese. With credit, Anthony Ruben Porras. Mark Dennis Portlock Jr. Nicolette Mary Rourke. Audrey Romero. With credit, Carlos Vicente Sanchez. With credit, Maya Elizabeth Sidhu. With high credit, Anna Margaret Simmons. With high credit, Anya Singh. With high credit, Leah Emily Smith. Sydney Val Smith III. With high credit, Ellery Talbot Sparkman. With high credit, Jacob Starobin. With high credit, James Pierce Stearns Simons. With high credit, Liam Blair Tasker. With high credit, Carly Emma Tilson. With credit, Logan Rockwell Tonra. Catherine Marie Traxel. With credit, Jack Stanley Ungar. With credit, Gabriella Anna Walsh. With high credit, Samuel Carlson Winchester. With high credit, Jessica Weixin Zhang. Congratulations to the class of 2020, the newest alumni of Middlesex School. Congratulations, everyone. Well done.
Congratulations, all you seniors.
Congratulations, seniors.
Congratulations! So proud of you, and keep in touch.
Congratulations, seniors. You've been wonderful, and I love you.
Congrats, Middlesex.
by seniors. Have a great summer. Good luck.
Congratulations, seniors. Good luck next year.
Congratulations, guys.